that's the only thing we can really conclude when we think about the story of our salvation, especially how it began. Think about it. The Son of God, the eternal Son of God, the second person of the Holy Trinity, became flesh within the womb of a young virgin. How did that happen? We know how children are conceived. Of course, the union of a man and woman contributes to conception. And at the moment of conception, a human life, barely visible, begins. So God chose this human process to accomplish his plan for our salvation. But God did not rely on the union of a man and woman. Instead, he circumvented his own design, and conception occurred by the power of the Spirit, by the power of God. That is why the child will be called, as Mary is told, the Son of God, not the son of Joseph. Then this child grew, as would any other child. He had to learn about his faith. He had to learn how to pray. He learned obedience to his mother and foster father, and obedience to God. Then, in a powerful act of obedience and love, he took up his cross and suffered death for our salvation. Sometimes I ask myself, you know, how aware was Mary of all that was taking place in her life and within her womb? Did she know the mysterious way in which she conceived? Could she really have understood the message of the angel about who her child would be and what he would accomplish? Or was she simply a young woman who faithfully trusted in God, even in God's mysterious ways? I tend to think that Mary really completely accepted God's will, and she learned over time what her son's calling would be and what role she would play in salvation history. And as difficult as it was for her to see her son suffering and death, somehow she held on to her faith that God's mysterious plan had a purpose. When the church approves of apparitions of Mary reported in various times in history, it doesn't necessarily understand how those things happen. Who can really know how supernatural events work or how God brings these things about? Oh, when we consider the nature of apparitions, we might conclude that they occurred at critical moments in history, like Fatima or Lourdes. The apparitions in Tepeyac, Mexico, served a larger purpose, to reveal the gospel to as many people as possible. And like any other human being, you know, Juan Diego had no idea how God was working through him. Like any other human being, Juan Diego had to trust that whatever the purpose of his apparition was would be fulfilled in God's way. Mary's appearance to him, her message to the bishop, the miraculous presentation of flowers, her appearance on Juan Diego's cloak, these defy human reason. Yet Juan Diego was open to following God's will in his life, just as Mary was open to God's will as well. So as a result of that trust and that faith, an entire continent came to know about the love of God through the message and the apparitions of Our Lady of Guadalupe. I think what we can take away from all of this is that God's ways are not our ways. There are some things we cannot understand. We don't know the full extent of how God's plan of salvation is unfolding and what role we are being called to play in that plan. What we do know is that, like Mary and Juan Diego, we are invited to trust and to believe. You know, we live in a world that relies so much on human intelligence, empirical evidence, reasoning power. Still, God's ways are beyond what we can imagine. So as we move through this Advent season, we need to learn how to place faith in what God has planned. The story of salvation, you know, continues to unfold each day in our lives, and we should just simply accept with joy whatever role God wants us to play in that mysterious plan.